Hello, I'm John Furrier with theCUBE. We are here in Seattle at the AWS reInvent building. This is the headquarters for AWS. Of course, reInvent is coming up, and the theme there will be all about agents and AI infrastructure, enabling and rapid acceleration of change and transformation and modernization. Sriram is here. He is the Director of Transformation and Modernization at AWS. Sriram, thanks for coming on theCUBE
here in
your building.
Thank you.
Kind of an away game for theCUBE, home game for you. You can just pop into the studio. Thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
The enterprise apps and agents, you're sitting at the crossroads of those two areas. We've covered, I think, on theCUBE and certainly on SiliconANGLE, Windows, migrating to the cloud. That's been going on for decades. Now, the game is still the same. It's expanded the scope of apps.
Yep.
And the AI enablement is creating an acceleration in not only migrations, but how they're done, the speed, but also in parallel, modernization.
Yes, absolutely. And that's what we're seeing. The need to move, the impetus to move is much higher than before. People are seeing the benefits of agentic AI kick in, and so their customers are demanding it. And so they're looking at how do I modernize my systems, not just lift and shift, but how do I truly make them ready for this new age? And so that's the impetus side. And then on the other side, agentic AI is actually making it possible to make these moves now much faster. And in many cases, you can modernize along the way as well. So
Talk about the current situation, but first explain where we were. Pre-AI mode we're in now, which has got a lot of benefits of which I want to get into. But what has been the traditional challenges? Because, in my mind, I've talked to a lot of customers, migrations, your head explodes, okay,
months
project
years,
management, it's a grind.
Right. Yep.
What was the current challenges that you guys were looking at, and what has been the answer?
Yeah, so I think if you look at what it was pre-AI, it was, usually big projects, you need expertise, you're thinking about years, you're thinking about finding the right people, and you may not always have the right people. If you have systems that were built 30, 40 years ago, how many people are there who know COBOL or that variant of COBOL in depth, right? And so you had both a time and an expertise issue. And then there were some maybe rule-based systems, but again, rule-based systems, they only handled a narrow set of things that they're coded for, right? And AI, agentic AI especially, makes it possible to do a much broader set of use cases, right? And we can encode our unique, we have a lot of expertise over 19 years helping customers move. We can encode all of that into these agents, provide the right tools for them, and that just makes the whole thing go so much faster.
Talk about that domain expertise. I think that's going to be key as the agent news we're expecting to hear from AWS starts to get smarter and more intelligent. You're already seeing the scaling laws on the AI and agentic side, have more, frontier-like capabilities. You're starting to see more reasoning, multi-step reasoning, mixture of experts.
Yeah.
These are the scalable side of AI.
Mm-hmm.
You guys have been doing this. I've been in SAP, Windows. There's a lot of other workloads you guys had customers bring over.
Yeah, absolutely.
What's the learnings there, and how does that connect the dots for this next level?
Yeah, so in AWS Transform, we've got a Windows modernization, we've got VMware modernization, we've got mainframe modernization. And kind of the broad learnings are, you have an assessment agent that's able to understand all your systems, draw up relationships between the existing components. And then, after doing the dependency analysis, you can kind of get to the next level, which is decomposition. What's the right structure for moving it into the cloud? And then obviously validation at the end, right? So you kind of have sort of purpose-built tools and agentic capabilities that allow you to kind of do the end-to-end workflow completely.
And what's interesting, I was talking with Deepak Singh, he's got a bunch of announcements, but he shared with me this morning specification-based coding with Kiro.
Yes.
I mean, he also pointed out that same thing, where in the old ways was you code what you wanted to do.
Yes.
And that was it.
Yep.
It's almost static, but with agentic, you have now agents and knowledge that can stitch up, build it, ship it, manage it.
Yeah, absolutely. Working off of specs. So for example, mainframe modernization, You know, we extract our documentations and what we call business rules. And then you work off of those business rules to either to modernize, to analyze it properly, and then decide what piece you want to modernize in which way, right? And so that's very much in that same vein. And use those same rules then to define your validation and tests.
Okay, you guys launched Transform last year. Give some stats of some of the momentum.
Yeah.
Because I think migrations is going to happen like lightning fast.
Absolutely.
Okay, but then that's not the next question is what happens next. Do you want to keep it, build on it? Well, you can just extract away what was once the operating model and then add new things to it.
Yeah.
That's where new coding comes in. That's where agents can come in.
Yeah.
Take us through that vision and that's momentum. First, give the stats and then talk about where it goes.
Yeah, so we've had, amazing stat on mainframe. We've had nearly 1 billion lines of COBOL code that's been analyzed in the process of moving to the cloud, right? And the reason people are able to do that really fast now, and then they're starting to think about not just moving directly to the cloud, but also reimagining those systems. We've had 40 million lines of .NET code that's been moved from Windows to Linux and saving customers licensing costs, so 40% savings on licensing costs. All of these, by the way, happening 80% automated, 4x faster, so just think about the savings there. And then on VMware, we've had, I don't have the exact stats on servers migrated, but some of the stats are just amazing. Network configurations can now be moved 80 times faster. Just think about that, right? It's just amazing speed.
Yeah, I mean, that kind of changes the industry landscape because competitive strategy would say, oh, yeah, it's the switching costs become one of those factors. Well, hey, you know, pay the tax.
Yep.
And then, you know, it becomes infrastructure.
Yep.
And then the cost to move it, disruptive operations.
Exactly.
These are huge things. And that never mind the partners that might want to do it.
Yep.
Hey, I'll help you move.
Yeah.
Then the professional services have to roll in. And I just think of room full of people.
Yes.
You know, coding or managing.
Yeah.
The project management, the coding, the time and the switching costs.
All of that. In many cases, it takes it down. Like we had one customer, who was able to make a move of a .NET application in days versus their plan of, you know, months. So that's just amazing speed. And then once you do that, you can also think about modernizing these systems.
Right. So getting into some of the weeds before I get into some of the futures that you're seeing, I had some themes here that agents are doing very well in, obviously coding.
Mm-hmm.
Hero mentioned that.
Yep.
Multi-agent collaboration and governance and security become a big part of the modernization piece of it.
Absolutely.
As well as the migration.
Yeah.
How is that playing into it? We're starting to see multiple agents.
We're starting to see multiple agents. And I mean, if you look at Transform itself, there are many pieces there. And these agents all collaborate with each other. For example, a capability might produce a documentation. Another one might produce business rules from those documentation. And then the testing capability builds off of that, right? And they're all sharing information with each other, right? And once you've done validation, say, hey, I validated these business rules, but maybe not that one. So let's go through another cycle with that. So that's multi-agent collaboration in real time with data, with the human as well involved in the loop.
And also workflow integrations come in there too.
Yeah.
You mentioned the mainframe, COBOL.
Yeah.
I actually took a one credit lab in college.
Oh, wow.
COBOL, actually hated it, but it was grind.
Yep.
It was as hard as my four credit classes. But, you know, COBOL, everyone knows, is an old language on the mainframe. You can't find engineers.
Mm-hmm.
There's an old joke that Andy Jassy used to say, yeah, the person that had the password, you know, is no longer alive. A little bit over the top, but the point is, they're still running systems. So those use cases in Windows and .NET, a little bit legacy, I can see that use case. It's very clear that most migrations, AI helps in the cloud, get them over. It's the new kind of, I call modern legacy migration that's still mission critical, but there's more of them. There's less, obviously mainframes still around, but not as many as, say, some of the mini computers out there and some of these old software stacks.
Yeah.
What is the critical success as you move from the low-hanging fruit, obvious examples?
Yep.
What's involved in a modernization and migration platform? Because I'm imagining it's a lot of those things we just talked about, governance. And then how does that fit into the AI architecture? Because now what we're hearing is agents are going to be adopted. You got AI native coding.
Yep.
That's involving models, a lot more model integrations.
Yep.
There's different tools for the job.
Yeah.
But it's becoming work.
Yes.
So the work product is migrate, run it, modernize it, add stuff to it,
yep.
make it part of the system.
Yes, exactly.
What's involved in some of these next set of migrations, and what's used? You guys cloning the architecture? You're gonna setting up the environment faster? What does AI do? What's the key?
I think AI is doing, you know, if you provide it with the right knowledge and tools, AI can do many of these pieces, right? It can, you know, if you're setting up a new network topology, if you give it kind of the mapping, it can help you set that up. If you're modernizing a system, say a monolith to microservices, you tell it which pieces you want to decompose. It can, you know, it can one, suggest those, mm-hmm. and two, can set up, you know, yeah. the system for you. It can create CDK templates for you, right? So you can do a whole bunch of things, and it's all about the knowledge, best practices, and the capabilities that you encode into those.
Sure. Talk about the where the apps sit. Sometimes we see multiple mm-hmm. environments.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes they're not even in the cloud yet. They could yes. be in the cloud, they could be on-prem.
Yep.
They could even be in another cloud or another provider.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not a one-to-one situation always. It just might be AWS to the customer, maybe a service provider, could be a GSI.
Absolutely.
So there's a multi-party
Absolutely.
Piece. Does that make it harder, or is that what? Take us through how that works.
So I think, you know, we've always had partners working with us, and they bring their expertise. We bring our expertise over 19 years, helping people move to the cloud. And so a partner may have specific expertise in an industry, mm-hmm. like financial industries, for example. And so-
Yeah, like Accenture and Deloitte's of the world.
Absolutely. And so that's a very much a collaborative process. They're also looking at AI tooling. Their customers are asking for the same speed that, you know, they're all hearing about. So it's a very much a collaborative enterprise. And again, some of the mechanisms I described, you know, encoding your knowledge as a knowledge base, encoding it as tools, those allow, you know, this agentic world that we're in, I think makes it very easy for multiple players to collaborate mm-hmm. as well. And so, you know, you can think about an agent that now knows about two knowledge bases, one from the code base, one from, you know, best practices, say from a GSI, and uses both of those to derive the next stage of the transformation.
I've been talking to a bunch of customers around, especially VMware and some other, not so much mainframe, but mostly like in the virtualization area, like VMware and others. They all say, oh, well, we're working with this boutique four-person company or mm-hmm. dozen people, and they're great.
Mm-hmm.
And they're smart, they're on Amazon Cloud, they're using all your tools, they're probably yes. customers, engineers. And they can do that work super fast. So you also have this other channel emerging. Is that good for you guys? Do you see that as a benefit? Because, like, do you care where the migrations come from, or do you care about where are you selling that directly, or how does the engagement work?
I think fundamentally, you know, we expect that some migrations will be done by customers themselves, some will be with boutique partners, some will be with more established partners. And for us, it doesn't really matter. I think what really matters is helping customers, you know, migrate to the cloud, build up more secure technical stacks, more scalable, and be prepped for, you know, the AI offerings that they need to build.
What are some of the things the customers are telling you on these migration monitors? I can kill two birds with one stone, or is it more of just
very much seeing that shift, right? You know, for a while, people viewed this as complex, and so let me get migrate first, then modernize. I think people are seeing the speed kick in, and so we're very much hearing people tell us, well, I actually don't want to do that. I don't want to do this two-step thing. I want to do it in one step, right? Help us do that, right? And they're starting to see our tools.
And what's the playbook for that? Because I would agree with you on that. That's a good call.
Yeah. The playbook for that is, again, these same ingredients that we talked about, mm-hmm. I think you kind of mix them up a little differently,
yeah,
right?
Depending
right?
on the environment.
Yes.
So,
it's, you know, this is, the I think, the flexibility of agents. You can say, well, here's all the same inputs. First, prioritize a migration,
yeah.
then do the modernization. Where now you can say, well, no, I don't want to do that. Same inputs, same capabilities, prioritize the modernization.
You know, in covering some of the migrations, I want to ask you the impact to AWS and others. One trend that I'm seeing is, and correct me if I'm getting it wrong, but let's get it out. they migrate with AWS, mm-hmm. and then what ends up happening next is, oh, there's ecosystem partners that they can work with. So they come on AWS, and then they're wrapping other relationships around it in the ecosystem. Are you seeing that? Is that something that's playing out, or is that more of just maybe my getting bad data or one-offs?
I'm not sure about exactly what you mean there, but what we're seeing is that people, when they come into the AWS cloud, they're able to innovate faster, right? And so they're able to do more with the assets that they had before. So it goes beyond modernization to new business opportunities, and maybe that's what you're referring to.
Yeah, maybe it's a different view, but if you come off, say, VMware and AWS, now you can work with four other people that maybe you could not,
you can do a lot more. The possibilities open up, right?
Okay, so the hot areas are what? Mainframe, what are the hot areas right now?
I think the product right now for Transform supports Mainframe, VMware, and .NET. You'll see us doubling down on that a lot more, broader set of capabilities even within those verticals, and then I think you'll see us just open up the aperture in terms of what else we can do, and that's coming at reInvent.
All right, so give me a teaser for reInvent, what we can see, and I'm connecting the dots here because I kind of know what's happening, but obviously agents are going to be...
You're going to see capability-wise, you're going to see more depth, you're going to see more breadth, you're going to see a ton more customer stories, right? As I said, billion lines of code for mainframe analyzed and so forth. So just ton of customer stories that are going to, I think, really excite people. And all of these, I think the agentic experience that we're building, I think you'll love it. I hope the early customers have seen it, they just absolutely love it. So I think you'll see much more us pushing the envelope.
In terms of your group for next year, 2026, post reInvent, mm-hmm. What's the focus? What do you see beyond reInvent? Just in terms of industry, as AI continues to go, the infrastructure, we're seeing it being built out. I mean, just more layers of abstraction making it easier.
Yeah.
The agents are going to come in full throttle.
Yeah.
We're starting to see edge, physical AI come in.
Yep.
A lot more traditional apps have to flex to the new stacks that are coming in.
Yeah, and so, there are people asking us, we talked about modernization for AI, but then there are people asking us, how do I just reimagine the entire thing? How do I rethink it as an agentic system even? Right? So, two steps of modernization all at once. So that is just exciting and, scary as well.
It's interesting, it's been the joke, AI for this and this for AI. So it's interesting, this is a wave now where we're seeing AWS bringing AI in.
Mm-hmm.
We saw NVIDIA is doing this aggressively right now. You guys are doing it. You're bringing AI to things.
Yes.
The physical world, you're starting to see a lot more impact.
Yeah,
new stakeholders are emerging.
I mean, the speed is just accelerating, right? Like every... You look back 1 year and it was like, my gosh, that was
I came in for the first time we came in at midpoint to a halftime reInvent check-in because so much has happened on the first half of the year.
Exactly.
And now that reInvent's here, it's a whole nother half a year turned into a year.
Yeah.
It's as if it's going to be like two reInvents going on.
I think the big story that I've seen is that customers are seeing this themselves. They're starting to come and tell us, hey, I think I need to do this. I'm hearing everywhere I can do it in a much shorter time. Help us get there.
So yeah, and that just reinforces this whole this bubble narrative, which is, I think,
absolutely,
yes.
Yeah.
Because the results are quantifiable.
The results are quantifiable. And people see it.
Yeah, and there's demand.
Yeah.
And also, it's moving the top line.
Mm-hmm.
So not only are there cost efficiencies.
Absolutely.
There's top line revenue coming in.
Absolutely.
That's where I think the modernization can be done in the one shot for two things.
Yes.
Because you get the cost reductions or...
You get the cost reductions. You get, you're able to offer your customers a better service with your agentic approaches. And that just absolutely...
Thank you so much for coming in and transforming this conversation. And we're going to migrate to the next video. This is theCUBE here in Seattle. Migrations may not be on the bingo card, but it's the fastest we've ever seen it. We're hearing that migrations and modernization are happening in one step. We're seeing a lot more of that as people are replatforming and rethinking with AI, how they do business with all the benefits coming. So it's going to be a big story at reInvent and beyond. I'm John Furrier with theCUBE. Thanks for watching.